Everyone, today we are going to continue with the second part of the Advanced R book, chapter 9, which discusses the second part basically is about functional programming. And it discusses three chapters, functional, function factory, and function operators. So today we're going to see functional. Hadley said, strictly speaking, R is not a functional programming language, but it does exhibit a functional style. So even though it's not that strictly functional programming language, but it does have or use functional style. And when we say functional style, we mean by in way which big problems are decomposed into smaller pieces and use combination or piece of combination to actually execute that kind of big task. So that's what we mean by functional style. And this is a quote which motivated the chapter by Stroud, the creator of C, that is saying is quite somehow confusing programmers when you have some kind of loops and conditions next step, and it motivates that you better use somehow functions, and in any way you can more or less avoid those complicated stuff. That's leads the idea of functional programming. In our the functionals we're gonna see in functional programming, it consists of function that we will see, and these functions are called high order functions, and they are here. So high order functions, for instance, the first one this chapter we're gonna see, which is functional, what you do is you provide a function as an input and you got a vector as an output. So that is called functional. This is irregular. What we do basically, you have an input and you have an output as a vector is regular function what we have. So this is basically what we're gonna see in this chapter. So let's dive in. So functionals are functions that takes function as input and return a vector as output. As we have seen here, they take functions and input and return vectors as output. That's what functionals are. And in R, the PAR package enhances the functional programming toolkit by coming up with a lot of functionals that ease the R functional programming perspective. Some of the functionals based R are these: apply, L apply, and tap apply. So this is just an example of what functional is. So let's dive into the first functional the chapter discussed, which is map. So basically map is a functional that has two arguments. It takes a vector and a function, and it maps that function to each vector, something like this. And it returns a list. So the implementation, as we can see for this map, is basically we are creating something like this, and we fill it. This is the basic implementation of A. And the base equivalent of map is L apply. So map is one of the things that we will be seeing in the chapter. But one thing with math functional is that it returns a list. However, as we have seen atomic vectors, we may require or need to have the returns to be one of those atomic vector, we may not necessarily need list as always. So map comes with different implementation for the equivalent of the atomic vectors, map this, this, and this, and all these atomic vector, for example, we have double here and it returns here. We have this one as well. Here, as you can see, this is anonymous function. We can, instead of writing something like this, we can write using this special feature for anonymous function. So that is different kind of producing atomic vector. So the first one is map, which returns, which is general concept, which returns a list. But if we need to return a specific atomic vector, we use the correspondence, this map. The next thing is extracting element from vector using map. So we can also use map to extract element of a vector. We can use three different ways. Like we can use, you can select character vector to select element of by name, and we can use by position, and we can use both by name and position. So this is an example of list here. We have this, and we can use map to select the element of this vector. So here we can see, we can select the element by name. So here we have this one, then we have 148. Else, the second way we can use select seen by position, we can see here by position, which we can select the position of two. We can see we have this. Basically, this is the second position. This is the first position. And also we can use the combination. Both name and position. And here we can have this. So we can see here we have both the combination, the Y and one, the first position, which is 259. So that is, but also, we can actually, if we try to subset something that doesn't not exist, if we can have an error, but we can pull a default argument here. Also the map here, you can see it returns if that doesn't exist. So that's the how to extract element from vector using map. The next thing the chapter I discuss is passing an argument with that .. So here previously we see that the map have first argument and a function, and it maps the functions to the function will be used like this. But what about if we have another argument here. So we can see one, two, and another one comes here. So this is another thing that the is discussed more in map variants, but it also been used here. So as we can see here, we have a list here, but we can pass another argument inside our function that we passed like here, but we can have this argument outside the function, outside the main. So here we have, as you can see, we have the same thing, but there is an issue when you try to pass the argument in this order. So for example, here, we can see we have, the vector, and here we have the function here, this other result. But what about if we pass it in different ways? So the issue is when passing with ., they will only be evaluated once and not every time the function is called. So here, this is the issue, but I quite don't understand why here, even when we pass it the same way and the same way here, our results is the same. But I quite didn't get it why here, the result here and the result here is not the same. Does anyone can explain this or understand this much better? It's quite somehow didn't understand it very well. So if you see here, we have three arguments here. We have this is x, we have a vector, and this is the, we have another argument here. This is the resolvable. Here we have this inside this anonymous function. As we can see here, the answer is different, but here is the same. But here is also different. But here we pass this inside the function, anonymous function, the second argument, and also here, but the answer is the same. So this is the what is actually saying, but I don't quite understand what they say. The fine difference is that when passing them as dot dot, they will only be evaluated once and not every time the function is called. Does this make sense to someone?
Well, the function, the map function is only being called once, right? So it doesn't, I feel like that would make sense because the dot, dot, dot are unnamed, they're just unnamed arguments. So basically you're passing in the last one, runneth as an argument to plus. So it's going to evaluate adding things to X. It's going to run that first and then as an additional argument to the plus function, run it. It's not going to do them in conjunction with, which is why I think they have two separate.
Okay.
But then again, the evaluation, I think I just confused myself.
Yeah, but the one here, I think they look the same. I don't know why here, when we pass inside the function, the anonymous function and the outside, they seems to be the same. I don't know why here, but yeah.
I mean, one difference could be because it's a random uniform, that it's a random function, like it generates random numbers.
Ah, yeah, yeah, I mean, okay.
So that's the difference between those two outputs.
Ah, okay. So you are saying, if this is not random, the output would be the same, right?
Yeah, I mean, I think so. It should be.
Okay.
Yeah, that's, gotcha. That's what the difference is here.
Okay. All right. That didn't even come to my mind because this is random. Yeah. Okay, uniform this. All right. Thanks. So here, using map, Hadley advised that argument names, we should explicitly provide the argument names when using map. So for example, write this when we have this rather than this. So because it's somehow to avoid missing up the function argument map and the function that is called with map, the argument of map look a bit odd and is called dot x and f instead of this. So the bottom line is the one passing the argument names always for the argument with this. All right. That is the first part of the map. Any question before we continue? Right. So the next part is map variant. So the map came with many variants, which are in total 23, that allows us to do different kind of tasks. The first one here we have modify. So modify is a functional that allows you to have, when you have an input, to have the same output. As we know, map does not have, if you have an input, map only gives you list, but modify the same output, input the same output. And we have map two, that is what I've discussed previously, that said will be discussed in map variants. Iterate over two input. IMAP iterate over an index and return nothing with work. And okay, let's see them. So the first one here, as you can see here, one argument, we have map, map logical, map, that is just the rest of the map, and modify and work. So when we have one argument, this, if you want to have a list, this is the map. If you want to have atomic, then you can have map logical and the rest of map. But if you don't want list, you don't want atomic, but you want to have, when you have a data frame as input, you want the result to become a data frame that you can use modify. And when you don't want nothing to be returned, just maybe something, you don't want to have a data frame as input and output to be a data frame or list as input, you don't want nothing, you need nothing, then you can use walk, as we can see an example. This is just two arguments, which these with two here, and this is one argument and index and n argument. So this it does provide n argument. So let's look at this one. Same time of outputs at input. So modify is a functional that allows you, when you have an input, the output, the corresponding output should be the same. So here, for example, we have a df here. And with map here, what we want to do here, this is our df, and here we multiply this by 2, and we can see it returns a list. But we sometimes need not a list, but rather we need to have our df as an input, and we have a df as an output. So in that case, we can use modify. So yes, we can see here it returns our df, the same input data frame, and also the same output data frame. But this, as we can see, this modify is for a single input. The second one is two input and friends. So here we can see the previous ones we have seen. Here is one input and we have this. So what about if we have two? So that's when math two comes into play. So this is an example here where we have the atomic. We have X and we have a mean. So we can call this atomic map double. So we have this result. But what about when we have maybe we want to calculate the weighted mean? So we need to provide weight. So we can see here we have two arguments. So you can see here we can provide this is the weighted mean and this is the weight and this is our vector. So we use map to not map this. And also at the same time we can provide the this function, because here we have any, we define any here, the first argument. So that's why here we all know when we have the mean, it will return the any. So we can remove the any here with this argument. So this is the second one, which is map two. So also it does have the same thing, the logical other atomic. Because here, if you look at it here, we hit the double, which is the atomic one. So no output, which is work. So we can see here, we have seen the first one, which is modify the same output, because we have seen these previous ones in the previous section. We have seen now modify. What about the work? So the work doesn't return anything. So let's see how it works. So here we can see mainly for functions that are called because of their side effect. So it's for only functions that they are called because of their side effect. So here we have something like this, welcome, and we can see here we have names, this vector. But when we call this map, this is the vector and this is the function. We can see that it returns this, but also it returns the list. But we don't want the function, we don't want it to return the list because we don't need it. So this is where the idea of work comes. So the idea here is that we can just have our this welcome without this the return value. So we can use the work function, ignore the value of the function. So here we can use this, and you can see that it just returns the stop. All right. Any question before we move on?
Quick question for me. On the modify,
all right.
Is that basically the same thing as doing, let's say I'm passing in a data frame. Is that the same thing as map DFR?
Map DFR. Do we have map D? You mean here map with DFR?
Yeah, so there are a bunch of variants of the map. So like that the term like data frame, DFR is row bind the data frame, DFC is column bind the data frame. But yeah, so you can, there's also map two versions of the same variant.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. So if I understand John's questions, like I think the chapter doesn't even discuss map DF data frame is also the same variant with modify. That's what you are taking up.
Yeah, John? Pretty much.
Okay. All right. Okay.
So we're trying to data frame, yeah. So that wouldn't go under like map LGL or double.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay. I was just passing in a list as an input though, so I guess I'm wrong. Because I often call the DFR, map DFR inside the data frame on a mutate call. And I was just thinking, oh, it's the same thing as modify, but I guess.
Okay, yeah, so maybe I think it is somehow because the map variant we have 23, maybe it is not listed here, but where does it fit the map DFR, where does it fit here?
I feel like it would go under modify or modify too, because it follows the same syntax as map and map two, right? They're just, you could have map two DFR, map two DFC. So then it would be modify two or modify. Now I don't know, this is the first time I'm like learning about IMAP. I've never had to index map. Even for PMAP.
Mm-hmm. Okay, all right. Okay, thanks. All right, yeah. So the next one is iterating over value of the index, which is IMAP. It lets you iterate over indexes or names. So here we have a vector here and the names here assigned. So we want to iterate here. We have IMAP here and we have something like this. A dot y has dot x legs. So here, because it's car, we're gonna iterate what is y here. So the first one here is gonna be the name vector, and here we're gonna be our the vector here. So here we can have a dot y spider has dot x eight legs, so it will iterate over that because it iterate over indexes or names. So here we can see here it iterates here over the names, and here it iterates over the indexes. But if we have on name vector, the second argument will be index. So here we unnamed the vector here, and we have something like this, and therefore we have this this n that y. Because it's unnamed, then it will say one has this is the vector eight legs. Then two because it's unnamed, so if it is named, then it will use the names, but here it's unnamed. So that's why if the vector is unnamed, the second argument will be the index, will be the index. So that is it. These are some of the useful constructor levels work with values along with positions. So the
did we lose him?
Yeah, Sham, you're frozen. Are you, Can you hear us? Well, at least until he comes back, we don't need to feel bad about not paying attention while we're typing in chat. Welcome back, Sham. You're
muted.
Okay. So I don't know what happened. My internet goes off. Am I sharing the screen now?
Yep.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So I was talking about the PMAP. The chief difference between that is with map two, we supply the first argument and the function here. But with PMAP, where is generalization of n input, we provide this as a list so we can use something like, so this is basically the same thing. We can write the previous function example we see with weighted mean. We can provide it as with a list rather than just listing the first and second one. So this is basically the PMAP. So any question with map variants before we go to reduce?
Quick question for me.
Yeah.
I warned you in the beginning, I have a lot of questions.
Yeah, I know.
For the IMAP, I often use the .y index to reference other columns inside a data frame. Is that a bad practice?
For the IMAP, right?
Yeah, so I'll use like a IMAP, I'll use that inside a mutate call, for example, to evaluate a conditional based on another column. So I'll use like df double bracket, I don't know, dot y at some other column. If that's value something else, do this. Is that a bad practice using index over other columns?
I cannot say what will be the ideal, actually. Maybe someone can jump in.
I don't know about IMAP specifically, but when I had to use dot y for any of the other map functions, like map DFR, for example. No, I don't think so. I just pass in my arg equals blank. Whatever it is that you need to pass in. Is that your question?
John.
Yeah, sorry. I'm basically trying to do what I posted there. Like I'll use column one, I'll map over that and I'll get the dot y from it to reference call two. I think you answered my question to Leila.
Okay, so you have your data frame, you're indexing dot y, if else df.
I think it's quite okay, this thing. But why do you think it's a bad idea?
I don't know. I just don't know. That's why I was asking.
No. I think this is okay. For me, I think this is pretty okay.
Don't know, because isn't you have your list. Oh, okay, so it's going to pass ID.
Oh, I should close that double bracket.
The double bracket. I'm sorry, I'm just trying to follow along because I don't.
Sorry.
It's supposed to go after a dot y, right?
Yeah.
And then, okay, so, but then call one is supposed to be passed into dot y. That's what you're expecting. This works. Right.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, I didn't even need the ID column there, but like I'm iterating over the call one and not even using that column at all. I'm just using that index, the row index.
Okay, so maybe this is just my lack of understanding of IMAP, because I don't know if you, like, why we would need it then if you don't, if you're not even using the ID column.
Yeah, ignore the ID there, sorry. Like I'm just iterating over like a arbitrary random column that I'm not going to use. And I'm using that index, row index number to reference other column. And oftentimes it's a row number column for me.
Yeah. So I think this is fine. And I think it would be dot x, because I think the functions typically are like dot x, comma dot f for the function, and then dot y or dot x dot y for dot f, and dot f if it's not two. But I think if it works, I don't see why this is bad.
Okay.
I don't see anything in here that's like really worrisome.
All right. So all these that what they call functional style, though R is not functional programming language, but we are using all these functionals.
I don't understand. I need somebody to like somebody that's very hardcore into like, I don't know, functional programming or C++ to explain to me technically why it's not a functional programming language. But I guess I could be safe for a Slack discussion.
Yeah. Yeah. So there are many reasons for a language to be functional programming. One of them is it does have functions that are pure functions. I think Hadley. Yeah. So if you look at this one here, every programming language has functions. So what makes a programming language functional? There are many definitions that make. So one of them is to have a first class functions. That is it. I think R has first class functions. But the secondly, many functional language requires functions to be pure. But a function to be pure, it must satisfy this. The first one is that the output only depends on the input. So if you call it again with the same input, for example, if you have sum of 2 and 3, anytime you call it, the input are always, the output is always be the same. And also the function has no side effect, like changing value of the global variable. So these are some of the things. I think I made a question concerning this, what makes it pure, and Brett and Hannes, we discussed in the Slack. We had an interesting discussions, what is pure language, pure programming language, pure function and stuff. Maybe you can get the reference. There is also a link Hannes share in the Slack. It is quite good explanation why what is functional programming in detail. Yeah, but maybe one can talk. Yeah, maybe Brett, and if you can chime in.
I can check it out, it's no worries.
All right, okay, let's continue. All right, so the next one is reduce family. So this is the like map, the reduced family only have two main variants, like not 2 and 3 of the map, and I use less commonly but powerful. And the main idea, they are the one that power the map reduced framework for processing large data set. We all know map reduced that have been used for processing large data set. So let's look at the basic ones. The first one, the reduced, but let's introduce the idea here. So let's assume we have this. This is a vector. And now here we have something like this, which is we have four different kind of it here. And this is the first one, second one, and third one. But we want to do something. How can we find gen that occur in every element? So how can we have four now? four vectors. How can we find join that appears here, this one, and this one, and this one? So one way to do that is we can actually find the first one. We can find what is the intersection of the first one and second one, and the results will be used and find what is the intersection between the second and the third one, and the result will be what is the intersection between the second and the fourth one. So we can have this. So it means here we is like we are reducing the complexity. We are taking two at the first. So this is it, for instance. We have this, this is reduced function. Here we have this and this. So when we take this, we can have one, only one result. So the only result will now be compared with the next one. So we can take the result from here and compare with the next one. And also here, the result we can take in. And so this way we do this can be achieved with reduced functions, and which automatically does that for us. So instead for us to take this, find the intersection between the first and the, up to the last, we can just use the reduced function and basically get the stuff for us. So this is how the reduce works. Also, we can do the same thing with union, which is basically the union as a set, and it can find the union of these vectors. So the because the reduced family are only two, the last one is accumulate, which is basically the complementary of the reduce. So it does the same thing with reduce, but accumulate is useful for understanding what really happens behind the scene. Or like reduce, it just gives us the answer, but the accumulate gives us even the steps, what matters. So if we look at this one here, well, here we take the first vector and compare the second one, what is the intersection? So accumulate will tell us, taking the first one, this is the intersection. So this is the output of this step. And the next one, the intersection of the second and the third one, the accumulate will show all the results and up to the last one. So you can see this is the last one. So accumulate is mainly for understanding how reduce works. Yeah. So. Right. So the this is the all right. The output type. So this is basically telling us if we have the you can have different output. If it is of the value of one or zero, it returns the same input vector. But also, if you don't want, you can have some initialization. And so this it may return something meaningful if it doesn't exist. So this is basically the concept of map reduce, as I've made mention, that been used to power the technology for Hadoop and stop those kind of technology that have been used for processing large data. So they are basically using the map and the reduce. That is why it is called map reduce here. All right. So the predicate functional. So a predicate functional is a function that returns a single true or false. So these are functions that return single true or false if some they match better. So let's look at an example. So there are a few also these predicate functionals. This we have df here, we define here, and also we have another one here. So it returns to the first one we're going to see is sum, is predicate functional. It returns through if any element matches. So here we have our empty cars here, and we have sum, and we have the df here. It's double, it's illogical. So it returns true if any is matches. So it's double, yeah, it's true. some empty car. It's logical because we don't have any logical here, and it's false. So, but what is the difference? My question is here, like, do we have any corresponding sum in base? Any, is this, is it the same with any sum? Another functional predicate is every returns true also if element matches. So the same thing here, we have every df here. We also have detect, which return the value of the first match, and detect and return the location of the first match. So this is another functional. We have keep all matching element. So this is, and also discard, we drop element of matching element. So here we have keep this factor, it will all drop everything. We can see here, we only have the factor and empty is double, it discards anything. Right, yeah, so this one and the same, and this one are the same because here this drops all matching elements. So it will drop everything that is in the and leave anything that is not doesn't match, which is factor here. So also map and modify come invariant. So we have seen map and modify. So they also come with variant where the results is true if it is true. So here we have map a df is numeric mean. So here we can see here we have df, and we can see here we have this is numeric, this is numeric, but this one is not numeric. So here we can see it, we can only find, if it is true, we can only find the mean. So here we can see here we find the mean of the first one, but we didn't touch this the last one because it's character, it doesn't satisfy this function condition. So also here, modify numeric. So we can see this one also the same, but also this one map keep also is numeric, it returns this. Yeah, so that is map predicate functions. One thing, these are the exercises, but I didn't even finish the exercise. One of the exercises, yeah, why is any a predicate function? We know any returns false, or true. As you can see, that the predicate function returns only true or false, but is any returns many as possible false or many as possible true and stuff like that. There are many. Let's go on to the next without.
Hey, can I ask another question?
Yeah.
On the map if, we did is numeric, is vector, or something like that, right? Mm-hmm. Is there an elegant way to write comparison of a number, let's say, like if number is below one, okay, is there an elegant way to write that?
If number is below one.
Yeah, rather than just passing in a function, which is numeric, I want to pass whatever we're looking at and its value, if that's below a certain threshold. Is that something we can do?
So why can't we have... Okay, so what you're saying is like, for instance here, we can, rather than checking whether it's numeric, we can have something to check whether it is some threshold, right? Is that what you mean?
Yeah, I guess it's at a column level, not a DF, like we have it here. But yeah, I think you got what I'm saying.
Okay, yeah. The last part, which is base functionals. So Hadley said these are not so useful in data analysis. And that's where maybe he they were not basically the some of these various functionals are not implemented in PAR because they are more useful in mathematics and statistics, but not data analysis. So here I didn't even discuss much of them, but this is an example of when. So here, when we have a matrix, of course we know matrix has not been terribly used in data analysis, but it's been used, for instance, in other stuff like modeling and machine learning. So we can use apply here, which is base function. So there isn't any equivalent for functionals that does this. So here we can find the mean across the row in the matrix, if it is one, if it is two across the column. So also we have another functional integrate, which find the integration of the given the function. So these are not terribly useful, as Hadley said, these base functionals that have not been implemented in PAR, but if one needs those, then he needs to use the base equivalent rather than depend on the PAR package because it are not implemented. So that's the end of the discussion. All right, so any question? So John, you say you have many questions, so let's go over the question. Oh, they are done.
Like, I mean, I just want that threshold thing I was talking about. Like, I don't know if anyone has a good solution. I can always use an if else, right? Like, I can iterate over a column and squiggly if else dot x below 5, whatever, whatever. I was just wondering if there was a nice predicate function. Like, you know, like when we're writing a plus, you can use a backtick to make it work like other functions. Like, I was wondering if there's anything like that with below greater than or equal sign, like that thing.
Okay, I'm not sure. So
if there are predicate functions to do, okay, yeah, thanks.
Like, do I have to use the if else?
Oh, are you asking if you have to use if else?
Yeah, I was wondering if there was a shorter way to write this.
Ah, okay. I don't think this on top of my head, actually.
Like something like that? I don't know if I can do that. See what I mean? Like,
yeah, I understand what you mean. I don't know if that would work.
I don't think it would.
No, I don't think so either. Honestly, I feel like what you wrote would be that's what I would write. But then again, I'm also learning, so.
Yeah, no, I'm just bringing this up because I recently had to use a lot of if-else in map. I think I used it like 3 times, like a nested if. And it just got out of control, you know what I mean? Like with the 3 if-else statements, it just went out of my screen.
I mean, did the if-else's have to be nested within your maps, or can they be brought outside and your maps inside your if-else? Does that make sense?
Yes.
So that you can like have more elegant code chunks? And then you can state multiple conditions, and the map only runs once. And I feel like that would save on resources.
Sorry, I'm just gonna bombard this one more time, but this is one of the function calls I used recently, and see the double if else there? Like, I was I just wanted to get that down to a, I don't know, like a more concise version. I don't know if that's possible, but without using VFLs.
Just looking at it. Okay, go on.
And couldn't you use perhaps case when?
Maybe.
Yeah, maybe case when.
Yeah, that's actually a pretty good, because then you can just have a mutate a case when, mm-hmm. one call one time, and then it would just be case when your condition would be, not condition, sorry, your output would be map this, map that, okay. map that. Or no.
Okay.
I don't know. I really like that solution also because it's in a dplyr verb versus the if else, but I don't know if one is slower. Has a slower benchmark than the others. Maybe this might the project faster. You have a long code.
I mean, the only input I have, especially for the second piece, I would write the function.
Yeah.
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 It's and in the function, you could write it a lot cleaner.
Yeah, I know. I just didn't know. I just had to write this four times, and I didn't feel like writing four different functions for it. But yeah, anyways. I think this goes back to the IMAP mapping that I was talking about on an arbitrary column, right? Like I'm using PF at dot Y index at row and some other columns like X and D, right? Without even iterating them. So I guess this is okay.
All right. So let me stop sharing. Thank you all. We still have volunteers to present some chapters. So next week we're gonna have Brett is gonna present the second part of chapter of the functionals, and which is function factories, I guess, right? And the next one is June. So if you are available to present any chapter, please sign in at the sheet we provided and get ready. For the terms, right. Thank you. Any question?
I was just looking at the map double and if else thing a little bit, and I'm still trying to understand the longer one, but the first one, you know, I mean, it feels like some of this is solved by the fact that if else is already vectorized.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So,
I mean, but yeah. In your case, you have at least, that's why you're using map anyway. Or you don't have at least, what's?
I have definitely done that when learning map. I've like, you know, done this map thing, been really proud of it, and then realized that the function that I was mapping was already vectorized. And so.
Oh, I know.
Right. But I think I may be missing something about what you're doing with the if else as a lambda inside the map.
Yeah, I just want to nest up a couple of conditions and just couldn't find a good way to do it. Like I have the tilde going in the first one and didn't call it in the second if else. But I don't know, I'll have to spend more time at this.
Right.
Yeah, I need to think about that second one a little more.
Yeah, sorry for the boom.
No, that's okay. It's just, you know, it just takes some, I'm slow at reading code.
My question is, this file package, one of the advantages they said is speed, right? So the base R applied and stuff like that, were they not written in C? Or which language were they implemented?
I believe you're right. I think it is C because you can call C from within R.
Well, if it is C, the power package also in C, they also have the same performance. It is the same performance, or one is having better performance than another, like power and the base R.
Yeah. So a lot of people that I know sometimes have to write their programs in C because mm-hmm. it's faster that way because of the, honestly, I've never done it. And this is for people that have to like run simulations and they have to run their code in parallel, like send it out. So they write their programs in C. That's the only like case that I know where they resort. I call it resort to writing in C versus just an R.
Okay. All right.
I had to, and hopefully will not. I don't want to.
Okay. So I guess we are done for today, and thank you everyone for joining. If there's no question, and we can see next week where Brett will give us a talk for the next chapter. Thank you all.
Hey, hold on, Shan.
See you next week.
Hold on. Bye-bye. And
hello?
I wanted to hear what Anne wanted to say. I felt like he kept trying to say something.
Yeah.
No. It's
he looked very eager.
But I didn't quite understand, but it's like the map we talked about, and we already found out that map is slower actually
okay.
than the base function. I can't remember which chapter it was, but when we talked about it, we found out that map is slower. Maybe Brad knows it.
Yeah, in the it was something in this, we had a discussion in the Slack about that. I'll see if I can dig it up. Basically, map is very, very slightly slower than the apply family because it does a little bit more input checking.
What do you mean by input checking?
That is a good question. I can't remember what it actually does now.
But we did some fancy graphs and stats and everything.
I think also just the fact that you can have this dot notation and you can use the pipes and you can use all of these. You can't do that with the apply family.
Yeah, there's a lot of nice features to it too. It's like it goes back to the old thing, like, you know, human time is much more important than computer time typically.
Okay.
But by
the way, I see now base is adopting the pipe operation. The recent base R4.10, they have pipe operation.
And I like the writing style because of Bash, and in Bash I also always write the similar piping, so it's I like it, the new piping of Bash.
Oh. All right. You like the new piping?
I just posted that discussion in the Slack. I think the best thing about that discussion of speed was the bench package, which I had not used before, which is very cool. So if you need to speed check things, I recommend that over the micro benchmark and those.
Okay.
It even checks that the things that you're comparing are actually the same thing, rather than just, you know, trusting you as the programmer to, you know, so like if you're testing two ways to do something, you want to make sure that what it does is the same thing. And bench will actually check that the two outputs are equivalent, whereas, you know, the other benchmarking functions will just trust that you've done that as the programmer, which I typically don't do.
Now I can remember what the discussion. There was also the rabbit hole with the null or something like this, where your first example didn't work because you had the null in there or something. You returned something like this.
So
So
what is the cheap advantage of using the PAR?
The advantage, writing and clean. So I think it's just cleaner to write and more easy.
Yeah, sure.
I totally agree.
No, and also all of the what's it called? Oh my God, my brain is already frying for the day. All the variants. all the variants of map. So like, depending on what your output wants to be, if you have a data frame, because the apply functions, unless you are really good with SApply, or it's, I don't know, to me, it's just, it's easy. If I need a data frame, I just map DFR or map DF.
Yeah. Yeah, that's like that's kind of an interesting thing about the tidyverse in general. I have a friend who doesn't like the tidyverse because the syntax is, because it's so verbose. But, you know, I find it easier to remember that stuff than, you know, like if you look at mapping in Python or in Julia, it's like you have to do all this stuff yourself, but you know exactly how the map function works because it's always the same. But then you have to do all this other stuff to make everything work the way you want it to outside of it. Whereas like MapDFR is so convenient that it's nice to have that as a way to do that.
Mm-hmm. But I also see the problem if you write break packages or something and you are really, we are now learning a package, which is kind of, you have to be careful kind of, because like, I don't know how I should say it, but it's not, you're learning an own language in a language, more or less. So it's,
yeah. Yeah, I guess if you're coming from other programming languages, quote unquote hardcore, as Anne put it, then I guess the tidyverse takes some adjustment. But I don't know. I quickly jumped in tidyverse and fell in love, except for when you get the bloody object of type closure is not compatible. And then that usually happens when I'm mapping for some reason. I always get that shit. Sorry, that stuff.
If whoever wrote that error message had just put PS closures or functions, that would have made everyone's life so much easier.
Yeah.
I know. Oh man. That always happens when I'm mapping for some reason. But anyways, otherwise, there's been instances where I've actually gave up and I switched to LApply or SApply because I couldn't deal with it anymore, because at least you know what you're getting. But that's the thing with the beta, the apply family, is like you know what you're getting at the end of it, but the map functions are very convenient, but sometimes they act very strange.
Yeah, it's like two different paradigms. Like there's the paradigm of like give you the simplest tools possible and let you put them together to do things, or the paradigm of like here's a power tool that will make these like perfect cuts in your what you're trying to build. But don't use it wrong or it'll cut your fingers off.
Exactly. All right, guys. So I need to hop off for another. So I'll
All right. So see you next week, guys.
Thanks everybody.
Thanks, ciao.
Thanks for having me. Have a nice day.
Ciao. No.